especially when we're talking about friendship, right? So we're talking about being together, and that's what I want to build on this week. Mark has been talking about, you know, last week started this friend request series about friendship. And, you know, as I said, I've been studying this and thinking about this myself. And this key verse is, I just want to take a look at this again that Mark brought up last week, Proverbs 13:20. And it says this, it says, "Walk with the wise and you become wise, for a companion of fools suffers harm." And Mark talked about last week that who our friends are have an impact on our life, just as this verse indicates. Who we hang around with has an impact on how we live our lives and the decisions we make. But what's interesting is I found that there's also another part of this that's true, that the foolishness that causes harm is sometimes when we don't listen to our friends and other voices in our lives. Can anyone relate to that? Right? When we choose not to listen, when we choose, as Jack brought up during the worship time, to do things on our own, typically doesn't go very well, if we're really honest. Even though we love that in our culture, we typically end up in trouble. A few years ago, when we were still in Idaho, we were moving out of one home, and we had this hide-a-bed, this sofa bed, whatever you call those things, that was probably from like 1830. I don't know. This thing was made out of lead. It was so heavy. It was awful. It took four guys to get it down, and so when we're moving out and need to get rid of this, I was like, how am I going to get this out of here? Well, a normal person would probably say, I'm going to get help. I'm going to call my friends, and I'm going to get help. But I'm, unfortunately, like a lot of stereotypical guys, and I hate to say that, but I thought, I'm going to figure out how to do this on my own. Real smart. So I think, I'll get some rope. That's the first thing I thought. So I get some rope, and I figure out a way to tie the couch up and get it braced around my body, and then I put cardboard on the stairs to kind of pull this up so that it's not going to, you know, it's not going to jam, and I can get it kind of slide up. And I'll be honest, I was pretty proud of myself. I figured this thing out, and I mean, it was hard. This thing was heavy. I don't know how heavy, but this thing was heavy. And I'm pulling this thing up the stairs, feeling pretty good about myself. And I get to that, you know, that point where some stairs, you have a little mezzanine, and then about three more stairs. That's where I was, and I just had to just shift this couch. And, well, you know that cardboard that I got to make it slide up? Well, guess what it also does? It helps the couch slide down. I lost control. I couldn't hold on to it. This couch, this very heavy couch, starts to go, and I brace with everything I have. You know, I'm pulling back on the rope. I'm leaning back, and I plant my foot down kind of on one stair, and I pull back, and I'm thinking, I'm gonna get this thing back under control as it's going down. This thing is heavy. Well, I have no control. And I hear this, as I brace, and this thing's starting to go down, it's all happened just like this. I hear this loud pop, and the next thing I know, me and the couch end up at the bottom of the stairs. And just that shock moment, like, this was a bad idea. Why did I do this? And then I get up, you know, kind of in the shock of it, and I try to take my first step, and I just hit the ground. I had torn my knee. As I had said it, that popping sound was my knee. And I had to have surgery, and get this, I didn't say this first service, so you guys will get this, you get a little special additional part. A few weeks later, I ended up in surgery to repair it. And the day of surgery, they go ahead and let me out. And my church there in Idaho at that time, there was a staff meeting that day. And I'm thinking, because I'm so convinced I'm so important that things can't happen without me, because, you know, I can do all things on my own, I tell my wife, I say, honey, let's just be honest, I'm high as a kite. I just got out of surgery. I'm on a lot of meds. I'm still on the anesthesia. It's not good, but I need to go to staff meeting, and there's things we need to cover and need to bring up. And so she did. She took me to staff meeting. Don't know why. She loves me or thought it would be funny. One of the two. And so she did. She took me to staff meeting, and I have no idea what I said, but I was told it was quite funny, and it was the most interesting staff meeting that had ever happened. But I can tell you this. We try to do things on our own, and it ends up in catastrophe, right? We celebrate in our culture, though. We say we want this kind of, you know, man that's, you know, self-made man who's going to conquer everything, do everything, you know, or self-made woman who can do it all. We celebrate that, but it leads to foolishness and leads to harm. See, I think what the Proverbs are saying that's profound is that friendship and wisdom are connected. There's a direct connection between friendship and wisdom. And that day, I was not acting wisely. I needed friends to come alongside me. We are not able to do things on our own. See, wisdom is this. I think wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment and acting on it, living it out. It's not just information. It's not just a degree. It's not just, you know, the stuff I know in my head. It's the living out of application, knowledge, and experience, and living out with good judgment. Wisdom is important, and wisdom is connected, as the Proverbs point out, to our friendships. And I want to delve into that today. Why does it correlate? Why is it connected? Why does it matter so much? Because I think often, as Mark pointed out last week, we look at friendships, especially as adults, and we kind of think, that's kind of a young person thing. As I get older, I don't have time for that. I don't have time to work out my friendships. I don't have time. I'm too important. I've got too much going on. Anyone ever talk like that in your head? You don't have to raise your hand. We think friendship, you know, I've got it on my own. Maybe we might say we're too busy or too important, too smart, or maybe the opposite. I'm not smart enough. I'm not good enough to have friends. So I'm too awkward, or whatever it is we tell ourselves, that we don't invest and develop friendships. I think maybe the biggest issue we have why friendships don't develop in our lives is because we think they'll just happen. Right? They just, you know, people just like us, and if they don't, they don't. And so we don't think we have to cultivate anything. But listen, like any friend, like any marriage, any parenting, any job, anything like that, guess what? Friendship takes work. You hear me? Friendship takes work. It says this in Proverbs 27:17, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. As iron sharpens iron, so did one person sharpen another. In fact, in the Hebrew, it's kind of this unique rendering. It basically would say, as iron sharpens iron, one friend sharpens the face of another. I don't know what that looks like, face sharpening. But that's what it says. It sharpens the countenance, some translations say, because face just sounds weird. But it sharpens the face of another. What that means is so simple. It basically means iron sharpens iron is not about my opportunity to abuse you and tell you what's wrong with you. Though it might involve saying a loving thing that's difficult. I've heard people use this scripture as like, I can tell you why I don't like you. What I don't like about you. What I don't like about the things you like. That's not what the scripture's saying. It's saying that when iron sharpens iron, so does one man sharpen another. One friend sharpen another. It's talking about bettering one another. That we make each other better. We make each other more useful. We make each other sharper. It is not saying that I can just say whatever I want to say and that's that. That's not what it's saying. It's saying we should live to better one another. The well-known Christian poet and philosopher John Donne in the early 1600s famously wrote in his journal, that's now a title of books and other things, and you'll recognize this as part of a larger writing, but he said, "No man is an island." How many have heard that? "No man is an island entire of itself. Every man is a piece of the continent, a part of the main." What he was saying in this bigger picture was that we don't do good on our own. We're not meant to be isolated. We're not meant to be alone. We're meant to be part of the whole. However, the problem is, if this is true in the Proverbs, if it's true in Scripture, if it's true in philosophy, it's true in psychology, it's true in sociology, but the fact of the matter is that though we know it intrinsically in us, we don't live it out. We believe that we're basically good on our own, especially in Western and American culture. See, we celebrate, think about it, think about the movies we watch. The lone hero or heroine, right? Who stands against all odds by themselves. And we celebrate that in all sorts of different ways. We celebrate the person who can do it all on their own. We even do this in Christian churches. In Christianity, we celebrate the super pastors who can do it all. We celebrate the worship leader. We celebrate the people that can, you know, that have the record labels and all that. We look up to them. They can do it all. The problem is that comparison then says, if I can't do it all, then we begin to struggle. We begin to doubt. We go through things. Bitterness, envy, resentment sets in. See, this version of friendship that I can just live on my own is nothing short of a lie. It's a lie. You cannot make it on your own. Now, that's not a fun thing to say to us all this morning, but that's the truth. You cannot make it on your own. You weren't made that way. And we know this deeply within us. We just resist it. We want to make it about us. We want to make it how we do things. And, you know, nobody's going to interfere with that. But iron must sharpen iron. We must grow. There's a huge impact of this problem in our society. It's not just nowadays, but it's been growing over the years. And that recently, the Surgeon General of the United States said this about loneliness. Interesting statistic. He said that when they did the study between 2014 and 2017, I think if I remember right, get this, over 40% of the U.S. population deals with loneliness. I think it's much higher. 40%, over 40% reported that they deal with loneliness on a regular basis. And this is what he said to the Harvard Business Review. He said, loneliness and weak social connections are associated with the reduction, listen to this, of lifespan, similar to that caused by smoking 15 cigarettes a day. I didn't say this. I'm no doctor. This is the Surgeon General of the United States. The epidemic, he called it, of loneliness is the equivalent, it's having the effect on our bodies, the equivalent of smoking 15 cigarettes a day. And he went on and he said, loneliness is also associated with a greater risk of cardiovascular disease, dementia, depression, and anxiety. At work, loneliness reduces task performance, limits creativity, and impairs other aspects of executive function, such as reasoning and decision making. He said this, for our health to work, it is imperative that we address the loneliness epidemic quickly. Fascinating, right? In another study that took the data from 148 studies, they concluded that a lack of social support predicts all causes of death. People with a solid group of friends or a good close friend are 50% more likely to survive at any given time than those without one. You will live longer with good friends. Isn't that amazing? Let me give you an example that's a little tongue-in-cheek and a little true. But where I'm from originally, I'm from eastern Idaho, moved out here just about 3.5 years ago, and where we live was close to Yellowstone National Park. And like Gettysburg, where I was at, there, a lot of tourists would come through in the summer, okay? Lots and lots and lots of tourists would come. And what would happen inevitably every year is some people would decide that they would go hiking deep into the heart of Yellowstone all by themselves. And let me just tell you, don't ever, ever do that. Every year, somebody thinks that there's a big cuddly bear that it wants to get close to, or a big bison or buffalo wants to get close to, and guess what? Every single year, somebody dies. Because they're alone. And there's signs everywhere. Don't hike alone. Don't, you know. We need friends in our lives. Another study at Harvard that was a 72-year-long study and concluded that the most fundamental revelation of the discipline of neurobiology, okay, our brains, is that we are wired to connect. Neuroscience, the study of our brains, has discovered that our brain's very design makes it sociable, drawn into an intimate brain-to-brain link-up whenever we engage with another person. 72-year study that indicates we were meant to be together. What we already know in Scripture, when Genesis said, when God said it's not good for man to be alone, that's not just for weddings. When God said it's not good for man to be alone, he meant all of us. We weren't meant to be islands unto ourselves. We weren't meant to be the lone rangers or the solo, you know, who do it all. We were supposed to do it together as iron sharpens iron. We're to better one another. See, we live in a society that craves real interaction, real relationship, but it tends to refuse to allow the iron hitting iron that we need to put work into our relationships. Relationships don't work, we can turn them off. Unfriend, right? Block. We don't have to deal with the deep stuff and make things work. We've got 1,000 other friends on Facebook, Twitter, whatever. See, I think we don't want to do this because we've forgotten the value of friendships. And we believe the lie that all we need is ourselves. It's just me. Me against the world. I'm going to prove myself. And just like me with the couch, we will fail. It's not very comforting, but it's true. See, what we've discovered is that we are the most connected generation in history. When I was a missionary in India over 20 years ago, I was in parts of India and I thought, oh my goodness, I'm so far away from home. My mom, I did a terrible thing and never called her for months. Don't ever do that when you're just 19 years old in another country. But I just was so excited to serve the Lord, I just didn't do that. And I felt so far away. And just recently, some friends were ministering in one of those same towns, and they're like FaceTiming me. It's a different world. But here's the thing. We're more connected than ever, but what the study shows, we're more lonely than ever. We're more connected, but we have no deep relationships. We were meant to be alone, as it says in Genesis, or meant to be together, not alone, as it says in Genesis. Yet the Bible makes it clear that our sin not only marred our relationship with God, but it also marred our relationship with one another. Think about what happens in the first generation. Envy, jealousy, bitterness, rage, murder, right? Relationships fell apart one generation. Because we made it about us. And we were never intended to be that way. We're made not just about me. It was meant to be together. I want to look at a picture of the kind of friendship that the Bible really calls us to in the book of 1 Samuel chapter 18. Real quickly, we're going to look at just a couple sections of scripture. And I'm going to this one's a beautiful picture of deep friendship. In verse 1 of chapter 1 Samuel 18 there, it says, "And David finished talking with Saul. Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself. And from that day, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return home to his family. And Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. And Jonathan took off the robe he was wearing and gave it to David along with his tunic and even his sword, his bow, and his belt. And whatever mission Saul sent him on, David was so successful that Saul gave him a high rank in the army. This pleased all the troops and all Saul's officers as well." See, what's happening in this passage is David isn't king yet. King David is just a boy who has just defeated Goliath. And so now Saul's concerned and wants to keep his eye on him. Who is this kid? The people love him. He seems to, in fact, it just talks a few verses down. It talks about the refrain people were singing. Saul has killed his thousands and David his tens of thousands. The people were celebrating who David was and Saul's concerned. But Saul's son Jonathan becomes a close friend of David. So close that the picture here of him giving his armor, his tunic, his cloak, his weapons is not a picture of just, hey, here's some, weapons for you and, I hope it's better than the ones you had. It's a picture culturally of Jonathan, who was supposed to be the heir, saying to David, "You, my friend, you are the one God has anointed. You're the one God has chosen." You catch that? If anyone had a right to be envious, jealous, fearful, upset at who this guy was who everybody loved, it would be Jonathan. But instead, as iron sharpens iron, he builds up David. You catch that? It's a beautiful picture of friendship. In fact, it basically indicates that David's success was partly tied to his friendship with Jonathan. You see that through the story of 1 Samuel. David couldn't do it alone. We talk about King David, but he was not on his own. And that's so important for us to understand. Later, David would write these well-known words, Psalm 133, which is one of the songs of ascent. These words became, what that means is these psalms that the Jewish people would sing on their route to Jerusalem for the different festivals. There are 15 of them. And in chapter 133, he said this, and the people would sing this, they still do. "How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It is like precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robe. It is as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion, for there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life evermore." See, David is saying right here so much of what we saw in his friendship with Jonathan. Without breaking it down too much, the picture here of the oil and the dew. The oil comes from Exodus 29, which is a picture of the warm anointing oil, the perfumed oil that was poured over Aaron and the priests. That was a point of first marking the presence of God, but second saying that you are set apart for God. So David is making this statement that when all God's people dwell together in unity, it looks like this, that we recognize that every person we see and touch is loved and called by God. Do you hear that? What if every person we encountered, we changed the way we think to this psalm, and we saw them as one who's loved and called by the God of the universe? Every person, every human. It's a beautiful picture. And then he goes on, and when he talks about the dew, it's to highlight the example of anointing, but it actually adds a sense of newness and nourishment, because Hermon was the highest mountain in the area, and when the dew would come in the morning in a dry climate, it was refreshing. They would collect it. This was life. Have you ever been with a group of friends or close family or something, and it just is so good? And you remember those times with such joy. They just had such an impact on your life. I think we have too few of those times. We're just, man, that was so good. That was so refreshing with my friends that at this event. Or we just spent time together. I can remember one as an example a few years ago. And my dad took us he organized this trip for our whole family. So it was my wife and I and our two kids, my brother, my sister, and my parents. And we went to Disney World. Which we had never been to Disney World, and it was probably about 10 years ago, May of 2008. And it wasn't about Disney World, because actually that place is kind of stressful, but it was about being together, and something about the time we had together. Some vacations you leave, and you're like, I got to get home. I need a vacation from my vacation, right? But this was one of those ones of like, this was so good, the time was so special. That I didn't, we flew back into Salt Lake City and we're like, man, let's just go back. I don't want to go. This was so good to just be together. And it was 2 months later. It was the last time we had that with my dad, that he was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. Those times we have together, that's what he's saying here about that eternal life, those amazing times of life enrichment, of building one another up, of recognizing how much that we one another is loved and cherished by God, is just a taste of eternity. When we're together with God in the new heaven and new earth. I mean, just a taste. The kind of joy, the kind of life that comes from being together. I know you've had at least one or two of those in your life. I pray you have more. But think about how powerful that impact is. Times with friends, times with family. Jesus would say a similar thing in another passage himself in John 17, and this is a passage where he's recorded praying for his disciples, first of all, praying for them. This is the night he's going to be betrayed, the night he's going to be arrested. He knows what's coming, and he prays this fervent prayer for them. And then he goes on to pray for those who would believe because of the disciples. Okay, it says this, John 17, verse 20. My prayer is not for them alone, not for just the disciples. I pray also for those who believe in me through their message. Guess what? That's you and me. Right? You understand that? Jesus here is praying for you and for me. Think about how powerful that is, first of all. Okay? And that all of them may be one, Father, just as you're in me and I am in you. All of them may be what? One. All of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you sent me. And then he goes on, he says, I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be as one as we are one, I and them and you and me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then, everyone say then. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Think about this. What Jesus is saying, this is so powerful. I've always loved this verse. He's saying that when we love one another, when we are in unity, as we just read in Psalms, the world will believe that he is the Son of God. Do you catch that? Do you catch how powerful that is? When we live in love, I want it to be about my great sermons or great church services or groups or any of these other things that we do in our programs. None of that matters, it says in 1 Corinthians, if we don't have love. We must live in love. He's saying, listen, if you want to impact the world, love one another. That's what he's saying. Man, we need this reminder. We grow better together. Later, John, the author of that gospel, would write the book of Revelation, and he said this in chapter 2, verse 1 through 7. And I'll tell you, there's so much background I want to give in this, and I'll just shamelessly plug our GSM class, where we'll be teaching on the book of Revelation, and you can come to that and learn more about the background. But let me just highlight a couple of things here in chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. It says, to the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the 7 stars in his right hand and walks among the 7 golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. Powerful words. Jesus is saying this, right? You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. And if you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Whoever has ears to hear, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So there's all this background, but the church in Ephesus was, let me just give you a little bit. It was a real church with real people, with real issues. And they're commended for something. And I think this is such a powerful thing for us to think about. They're commended for their doctrine. They have it down. They know their stuff. They do church well. They have good sermons. They have good teaching. They have good worship. They have good programs. They're doing it right. They hate false teaching. They resist it. And they're commended for this, and that's a good thing. But then what he says is this incredible rebuke is he says, I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. And I grew up thinking what this passage was saying was that what I've forsaken is loving God, and so I needed to do more things to love God. I mean, I'm just being honest. This is what I would hear, and I even thought this is like, oh, I've forsaken my first love, so I better go to church more, and I better read my Bible more. Those are both good things. I should worship more. I should do stuff more, but that's actually not what the passage is talking about. Though those are good things, it's not saying, hey, do more so you have more love, because how many of that's not true? He loved us. He first loved us, and we respond with love. We can't make our God and Savior love us more. We're already so deeply, vastly loved. That's not what this passage is saying. I grew up believing that. Believed it for a long time. But when you actually look at the context, what he's really saying is, look, you have all your stuff together. You're doing church well, but you've forgotten to love each other. You've forgotten the things at first where you loved one another. And that does affect our love for God, because Jesus said, when he said in the greatest commandment, he said, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your soul, and your mind, right? Your strength. And the other, in the second, he said, is to love your neighbor as yourself. And by putting those together, what he was saying is you can't separate the two. You can't just decide, I'm going to love God today because I hate people. Some days you want to, right? But because of his love, we're meant to love each other. We're meant to live in love. You catch that? So what John is saying here through John to the church, to us today, is that we may have all our morals, our politics, all our stuff in place, and we may shoot that stuff on Facebook, and we may have all these opinions and preferences, and that's fine. But if we are not walking in love, we are not winning the world, we are not impacting the world, and we are not being who God made us to be. You catch that? That's a hard thing to swallow a little bit. But the truth is, we've forsaken our first love. I know I have. I like to be right. I like to be right. I like to get my way. And I like to do things my way. But as Paul said in Corinthians, it doesn't matter how good we are, how much we have together, our prophecy, our tongues, our knowledge, our whatever, it's all a clanging gong if we have not love. This theme carries on throughout Scripture. It's a powerful one for us to consider today. Love the Lord and love people. See, I love the picture in this passage. One last key point is when he says the promise of those who overcome, they will be given the right to eat the tree of life. Is actually, Revelation is this beautiful picture, just kind of all together. But it's pointing to the end of the book when the new heaven and new earth come together. And at the center of this is the city of God, and out of it flows the river of life. And there at the banks of the river on both sides is the tree of life. And where the fruit of the tree falls, it brings healing to the nations. So the passage is actually bringing us back to Jesus' prayer in John 17. That when we love each other, it brings healing to the world. Isn't that powerful? See, true togetherness, true friendship, the iron sharpens iron kind of friendship can literally change the world. And I believe that because Jesus said so. The world will believe. So how do we practically move from the self-centeredness and isolation into true biblical friendship? Because it matters so much. How do we break the cycles in our lives? And I don't have like 5 steps of being a better friend. There are things out there for you, and that's not bad. That's good stuff. It's not bad to consider those things. But at this point today, I want to talk about the change that needs to happen right here. The internal change that we need. So I want to highlight 2 things. 2 things that I believe will change the way we live and the way we walk out our relationships, our marriages, our friendships, with our parents, with our children, with our families, with our neighbors, with our workplace, with people in our workplace. Simple 2 things. Humility and gratitude. Listen, humility, it's not about self-hatred. It's not about, oh, I'm just so terrible and I look down upon myself. You've probably heard the adage, humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking of yourself less. Ever heard that phrase? Humility is not looking at how terrible I am. It's just me acknowledging I can't do it on my own. It would be me on that day with that couch calling my friends before doing something stupid. That would be humility. It would be people before they go hiking in Yellowstone on their own, calling some people and saying, let's hike together. You catch this? Humility is realizing we're not meant to be alone. We're not meant to do it on our own. And that isn't actually strength. Strength is when we say, I need help. I can't do this on my own. And we need this understanding. Humility is the active acknowledgement of the eternal value of others around us. It is not me being the strong one. It's me being the humble one, the honest one, who values one another. It communicates value. You know, I can get so busy, so caught up in stuff, and this last summer, Mark was doing this series on taking care of our soul, and I'd been thinking, just as we were going through that as a church, about my own soul and how much I was struggling with even just my own friendships. And so I began to study it and think about it, just praying about it, reading some stuff on it. And I came across something in early Christianity that's kind of been abandoned and even absorbed into other things, unfortunately, that was actually a Christian practice in Ireland in the 400s to the 700s. And it was basically this. They understood the concept that we can't do it alone. Like you could not function in community on your own. And so they actually had a phrase in Gaelic, in Irish language. It's mo anam cara. You learn a little bit of Irish today. Anam cara means soul friend. And the point was, is they realized that you cannot grow on your own. And so the most important part of your life wasn't your mentorship. It wasn't your education. It was your soul friend. You needed somebody to walk alongside you. And this was part of their society, and they had this whole thing connected to it. And at the core of it was the recognition that we can't do it alone. So I organized this trip to the mountains with some friends. And when I say mountains, I love Pennsylvania, but I'm from the West. So I flew out to Idaho, where we have some mountains. And it's beautiful here, but I needed some mountains, okay? And so we go up in the mountains, and all of us guys get together, and you know, the first thing that guys do is even though we're all struggling, and these are dear friends of mine, we all get there, and what do we tell each other? Hey, how you doing? What do we say? Fine, great. Women do this too, but guys are a little bit worse at it, at least in my experience. Oh, I'm doing fine. And that's exactly what we did. I mean, we're up where there's no cell phone service, and we're scrolling through our phones, right? Because that's how disconnected we are. I mean, it's just habit. I mean, we're sitting there around the campfire, and there's no service. There's no people for miles and miles, and we're scrolling through. And then it just took one person to say, I'm struggling. One person. Would you guys help me? And it just became this whole week of us walking through stuff together. And I can't tell you how beneficial that is for my soul. To just walk together, to just talk about life. And we did a lot of fun stuff together. We hiked, we were on lakes, we did great stuff. But it was just that honesty that said, I cannot do this on my own. We have ways to be a part of this. Men, there's a men's retreat. Go to it. Get involved in that. We have many churches coming up. Get connected. Get in groups. Grow together. Walk in humility. The second step, my last point this morning, is gratitude. You see, I think it's often a lack of gratitude that destroys our relationships. We tend to think of gratitude as only something we express when someone deserves it. That we only say, hey, thanks when somebody's done something for us. But Scripture tells us in Colossians 3:15 and many others, this is just a great example, Paul says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body, you were called to be peace. And then he just gives this simple command, and be what? Thankful. To just be thankful. And I promise you, it will change your life if you just take that command and walk it out. Just be thankful. Cultivate gratitude. Discipline yourself in gratitude. Listen, friendship is iron sharpening iron. It takes work. It doesn't just fall in our laps. But when we cultivate humility and when we cultivate gratitude, watch your demeanor, watch your attitude, watch your relationships at home and your marriage and your families, your workplaces, watch them change. I promise you. 21 days, I want to give you a challenge. Do something I've never done. It seemed to work okay first service. But normally these things right here, we all have a cell phone. Most of us do have a smartphone. And those who don't, it's better to do what I'm going to tell you in person than on a phone anyway. We're going to try something here. Most of the time we get on these things and we get on Facebook, we get on the news, we get on other things. We're reading hate and vitriol and people not getting along. And then we see a couple of cat videos and then we read some more hate and vitriol, and right? I mean, it's not about the internet, right? But what if you change something for 21 days, you actually disciplined gratitude in your life, and you just thanked someone publicly, and if you don't have social media, great. I'm actually thinking about getting rid of it myself. Tell someone to their face, call them up. But I want us to do something. Take your phones out if you have them today. Yes, take them out. And then those of you who had them out and you're actually scrolling Facebook, we'll just believe you're on Scripture and reading Scripture. No, I understand. Get this out. And I actually want you right now, just for a second, and we're gonna wrap up and take communion and we'll be done. But I want you to do something. If you don't have this, think of someone you can call or text later. Or even the person sitting next to you. And I just want you to say something simple and say you're thankful for them. It's not that hard. Let me give you an example. I have a lot of people I can thank that do things all the time. And so I want to pick on people in the back. So earlier I thanked Chris, who works back there on the computer every week, does so much hard work, but also Sabrina back there. I want to thank Sabrina this service. So I can do a little bit different. Sabrina's running our sound today. That's an incredibly tough job back there. There's a lot that rides on what our sound people do. And I'm so grateful for her and for Chip, who work very hard at learning that and doing that. That's all it takes. That's it. Just say thank you. I promise you, if you listen, this is not just a silly little, oh, the pastor said do this. I'm telling you, if you live in gratitude, it will change your life. It will change your relationships. Just discipline yourself and 21 days, thank someone different every day. Whether it's text, call, to the face, or on social media. A little less cat videos and a little less hate. And just thank some. I want you to actually do that right now. Those of you got your phones out. And if not, you can turn to someone or think of who you can text or call later. But I've never done this. This is the first time I've thought of this in a church service. Some are like, this is heresy. He's telling us to get our phones out. No, I just want you to be thankful. And use what's usually a medium that actually isolates us to break isolation. Be thankful. Take a minute and do it. While you're finishing that up, see, choosing to be grateful, it will change you. It will sharpen your soul. Gratitude is an outward expression of humility. And in essence, friends, when we choose humility, we'll be more thankful. And when we choose to be more thankful, we'll develop more humility. You catch that? Changes who we are. See, I believe Jesus' words are true, that if we actually love one another, it'll change the world. I don't think Jesus was joking when he prayed that prayer. So we're going to do something as we close, and we're going to take communion. And before you do, okay, before you take it, don't partake, don't pass it out yet until I explain something. Because I want to say something about communion that's important. The picture of communion ties right into what we're talking about when we talk about friendship. Because the biblical model of communion was not that we go to church and we do a ceremony. And I'm not knocking anything or any traditions or anything like that. But when you look at Scripture, what communion, what it meant to come together and break bread, to remember the Lord and what he'd done for us, this is what it looked like. They'd wash each other's feet. Imagine that. And if you understood Asian culture and Middle Eastern culture about how the foot, the dirtiness of the foot, it's like the worst, you don't touch it. But they would serve one another and wash each other's feet. They would eat and then they would partake in the communion together. That was communion service, because at the core of it was that word, service. They did it together. It wasn't like me, and I'm not knocking anything, there's a place for this, but it wasn't just me and Jesus. It was us. Jesus. You understand? So here's what I want you to do. Again, I know I'm probably stretching some of us this morning, and I don't mean to make anyone uncomfortable, but I want us to get this, because I don't think we can quite understand it just with information. I think we have to walk it out. And so at the very end of your rows are the communion, the juice and the bread. What I want you to do is I don't want you to take it for yourself. And so the very first person's going to have to, you're going to have to work it out. But I want you to serve the person very simply by holding them out to the other person and serve them. Let them take the elements from you. And then I want you to work that across the aisle. I know this will take a little bit longer, but I would like you to do that right now. Just take a minute. It'll take us a couple minutes, but serve one another in a simple, practical way. And then we're going to partake together. So don't take yet. We'll partake together. Isn't it amazing? We're actually interacting. there are smiles on people's faces, and we're enjoying it. I think that's a better picture of communion than a lot of times what we actually call communion. Because it's us coming together as one, as He and the Father are one, so that the world would know that He's the Son of God. Amen? So let's bow our heads. I want to speak something and pray something, and then we'll take and we'll be done. But see, the truth is, as we hold the cups and the bread together, is the most perfect example of friendship is Jesus, who humbled Himself and gave Himself and lowered Himself. He said He didn't come to be served, but to serve. Who gave of Himself, poured out His blood shed, His body broken, so that we could be in right relationship with Him and with one another. The bread and the cup don't just represent what He's done for us, but that we're all part of it together. It isn't about just me, but it's about us. As iron sharpens iron, as we grow together, as we build one another up, as we sharpen each other. The heart of God is togetherness, unity, community. And no greater picture than that, than what Jesus has done in the shedding of His blood and the washing of our sins. And His body that was broken, that we would now be whole. And that doesn't just mean individually, it means all of us together. Washed and made new and made whole. Are you grateful for that this morning? I'd like you to just tell Him that in your own words. Just tell Him. Just, you don't have to shout it. Just speak gratitude. Just say, thank You, Lord. If that's all you can say, thank You, Lord. Lord, we thank You for Your blood that was shed, Your body that was broken. Thank You that in You we are whole, we are new. Lord, would You fashion in us humility and gratitude? Help us walk it out with wisdom. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take and eat and drink. We stand together. I just want to sing this one verse of this song we sang earlier, "In Christ Alone," because it speaks, as Pastor Jack said earlier, to the truth is we can't do it on our own. And the best thing you can do today is acknowledge that you can't do it on your own. If you don't know Jesus, we'd love to pray with you up here after the service. We'd love to talk with you because you can't do it on your own. More than anything, you need Him. You need His forgiveness, His blessing, His friendship. As Mark said last week, He not only loves you, He likes you. But as we close in this, before we do that, I'd like us to sing these words together to declare that it isn't about us, it's all about Him. Amen? So in Christ alone, let's sing these words together this morning.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. My light, my strength, my song, this cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when bears are still.
help us to be one as you prayed so passionately in John 17, as you are one. Would you teach us to be those who love one another as iron sharpens iron? We would build one another up, Lord. But instead of walking in envy or bitterness or spite, resentment or insecurity, Lord, that we would instead choose gratitude and humility. Lord, that we would choose to be thankful for those you put in our lives, that those we come across, that we would recognize it's not all about us, that we can't do it on our own, that we need you and we need others. Help us walk that out in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen and amen. Listen, if you'd like prayer for any reason or if you have like to come to know Jesus this morning, we'd love to pray with you. We'd love to talk with you. Please come up and pray with us for any reason whatsoever, though. And be blessed. Have a wonderful week. Remember to be thankful.